We are most excited that Jesus is in the building right now. Hallelujah. Jesus is in here right now. And because he's here right now, there's no telling what's going to happen. Somebody is going to have a miracle in their life right now. There's a healing that's going to take place. There's a restoration that's going in this building right now. There's an outpouring of the Holy Ghost. And God's fixing to do a work. Hallelujah, through the man of God. Hallelujah. Why don't you all stand with me today? Let's give the Lord one more time of praise. Let's worship him. As our evangelist comes up, Brother Yates, come on. Take your liberty tonight. Preach the word of God.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. Can't nobody do me like Jesus can. Amen. I just want to say this. I want to go ahead and just clear the air. If you're here tonight and you really want the Holy Ghost, you don't have to walk out them doors without it. Let's go ahead and set it straight. If you want the Holy Ghost, it's here. Amen. That is the purpose of this revival. Jesus Christ came to seek and to save that which was lost. Well, hallelujah. What a beautiful presence of the Holy Ghost that is in this house. And I am honored to be here and to preach again in Las Vegas, New Mexico. Amen. I told some of the folks back home, they asked me where I was going this weekend. I said, Las Vegas, baby. New Mexico. Amen. I know there's been praying and fasting going on for this service tonight. And I feel it. And if you don't know how it feels to get up in the morning and leave the humid weather of Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and fly to 60-something, 100 feet above sea level in one day and then preach. I'd love to be shouting tonight, but last time I did that, I about passed out. So I kind of took it easy. Now, if anybody's got a cold Red Bull in your car, I'd take it right now. Amen, but I am glad to be here with Brother and Sister Langford. Amen, my dear friends. And that little boy just, he cracked me up tonight, man. Worshiping all these babies. Let me tell you something. Let them babies worship God. Let them run the aisles. Well, that's better than watching SpongeBob all day long. I mean, Tom and Jerry is way better than SpongeBob. Come on. All right, let me go on. I'm going to get... But it's great to be here. I appreciate everything that has been done for me in a nice basket in the room and had some of my favorite goodies in it. And man, nice, clean room. And it's good to meet Brother. Well, Walker. I had his name, Brother Stephen Walker. I knew Stephen. But it's good to meet Brother and Sister Walker. Enjoy that singing. Amen. Amen. You're going to break through in your city. Come here, Sister Walker. I'm just going to get started right. Y'all just hold on. I'm finna preach. I'm going to tell you what the Holy Ghost spoke to me. The Holy Ghost spoke these words. He said, there's a wall that y'all been up against. And that's the first thing he said. I said, God, what kind of wall? He said, a wall of discouragement, and tell him I'm going to break it down. And the words that he said was, be not weary in well-doing. For in due season you're going to reap if you faint not. In the name of Jesus, God, you know every sacrifice. You know every day of her life, every moment, every second. You know where they're at, God. You know where Durango, Colorado is. Every stronghold will be broken. Discouragement, you spirit of hell, I bind you in Jesus' name. And I command you to leave that city. and that church.
My God, have mercy.
Well, hallelujah. Clap your hands and worship the Lord. Well, hallelujah. Somebody say praise the Lord. If you have your Bibles, let's go to Genesis 19 and verse 15. Amen. The Holy Ghost is in this house. I'm telling you, sir, God's going to break it down. My God. How many fathers do we have in here tonight? Raise your hand. Good. And when the morning arose, then the angels hastened Lot, saying, arise. Genesis 19 and 15. Arise. The angels hastened Lot, the daddy, the father. Take thy wife and thy two daughters which are here, lest thou be consumed in the iniquity of the city. It is your job as a father to lead your family out of iniquity and not into iniquity. And the words in verse 16 kind of bother me. And while he lingered, while he hesitated, while he tried to make up his mind if he was going to leave, the men laid hold upon his hand, upon the hand of his wife, and upon the hand of his two daughters. The Lord being merciful unto him, and brought him forth and set him without the city. And it came to pass that when they had brought them forth abroad, they said, escape for thy life. Look not behind thee. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Neither stay thee in all the plain. Escape to the mountain, lest thou be consumed. And Lot said, oh, not so, my Lord. Behold, now thy servant hath found grace in thy sight, and thou hast magnified thy mercy which thou showed unto me in saving my life. I cannot escape to the mountain lest some evil take me and I die. Behold, now there is a city near to flee unto. It is a little one. Oh, let me escape thither. Is it not a little one? And my soul shall live. And he said unto him, see, I have accepted thee concerning this thing also, and I will not overthrow that city or this city for the which thou hast spoken. The Bible says in verse 24, the Lord rained upon Sodom and Gomorrah brimstone and fire from the Lord out of heaven. And he overthrew those cities, all the plain, all the inhabitants of the city that which grew upon the ground. But his wife looked back from behind him. And she became a pillar of salt. And while he lingered, and then he said, look not behind thee. And he said, you got to leave, because I cannot do what I'm going to do to this city until you get out of it. You know why? Because of a praying uncle. So my message tonight is this subject thought. When God drags you out of hell, don't look back. When God, when he gets you by the hand and says, come go with me, don't look over your shoulder. I am talking to people in this room tonight that God has drug you out of hell, that has pulled you out of the pit, that has pulled you out of sin, and it is not a time for you to look back, give up, or give in.
Oh, my God.
You may be seated. Amen. When Abraham, when God visited with Abraham, and said, I'm going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. Look, I don't care what your political preference is. And I'm not going to get into a political dialogue tonight. I'm going to tell you something. Our world's in trouble right now. Some of the junk they trying to run down our throat is in trouble. And the Bible says, as we were in the days of Sodom and Gomorrah, so shall it be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. You better wake up and understand what's facing the world right now. It is up to the men, the head of the household, to get your family by the hand and drag them out of hell. Amen. Sodom was so wicked that when the angels of the Lord came, the men of Sodom wanted them to come out so they could do ungodly things to them. God had to blind them, had to smite them with blindness. They were so sinful that he had to temporarily blind them to keep them from breaking down Lot's door. Sin leads to spiritual blindness. When we're overcome with sin, we lose our spiritual direction and our spiritual discernment. So the best thing you can do is keep sin out of your life so you can lead your family. Psalms 119:18 says, open thou my eyes that I may behold the wondrous things out of the law. He's saying, God, give me vision so I can see what you're trying to do for me. Repentance brings direction. Repentance brings direction for your family and leads your family from destruction. God had to send angels. Why is it that when the preacher or the man of God tells you you need to get your family out of the world and don't live that way, that they just have to be drug out? Abraham was praying for God to save Lot and his family. He said, God, look, if I find 50 souls, will you spare Sodom and Gomorrah? He said, yeah. He said, Lord, another question, God. If I find 40, will you spare Sodom and Gomorrah? And then he said, well, he kind of had a little doubt. He said, Lord, if I can find 20 people, will you spare Sodom? Yeah, I will. And then he said, you know, that's a stretch. I know I may have Lot and his girls in there. That's 3 and his wife. That's 4. How about 10, God? He said, if you can find 10 righteous, I'll spare Sodom and Gomorrah. I want to tell you something, Las Vegas. I'm looking at more than 10 people in this room right now that want to move of God. It is God's will.
My God, have mercy.
It is God's will that you have revival in this town, that you have a move of God in this town. It is the will of God that you have revival. And I'm going to tell you right now, if I be a man of God, God is going to bless you in a building and bless you in the church. My God. Abraham's prayer and communication got him the title of a friend of God. We need to have a relationship to God in prayer that when we open up our mouth, God steps on the portals of heaven and says, that's my buddy right there. What you got to say to me today? That's my friend. You see, getting from God is all about relationship.
My Lord have mercy.
I got a little 25-year-old red-headed daughter. She got married on me about 3 years ago. She had married such a good guy, I wouldn't like him, but he's a good guy. And y'all tell him I said that. But man, I was in Anacoka, Louisiana the day, and I was looking through my briefcase, looking at some stuff, and I pulled out a card, and I didn't realize I had that card in there. And it said, to my dad on my wedding day. And I opened it up. And the tears begin to flow. That's my girl. Didn't care what they're waiting for. That's my girl. If not-headed boys, you slap them upside the head and tell them to shut up and tell them to room. But boy, them girls, they something. What do you say? It's about relationship. when you got a relationship with God, you there's some favors that go in relationship. There's favors that go to your girls right there, right? There's some favors, all right? Because there's a relationship. My God, have mercy. I want to be a friend of God. And I want to tell you the best way. Hey, God loves people that are willing to say, I'm going to turn my back on Sodom. I'm going to walk away from sin. I'm going to take my family by the hand. I'm going to lead them to God. I'm going to walk right. I'm going to live right. I'm going to tell you something. God has sent me here with a word for somebody in this building. When God drags you out of hell, don't desire to look back. Don't try to go back. Don't look over you. Abraham, the Bible says, believed God. It was imputed unto him for righteousness, for he was called the friend of God. Abraham knew God heard his prayers. Abraham knew God answered prayer. What's this? The reason God would not destroy Sodom and Gomorrah until Abraham got out, the only thing stopping God was Abraham praying. I'm going to tell you right now, could it be that your prayers, and it is the only thing stopping your family from being destroyed? And could it be that the prayers that you prayed is what's got God's hand standing in front of your lost loved ones, saying, no, devil, you can't take a soul. No, you can't destroy him. You can't take him, because somebody in that Pentecostal church is praying for him. You can't take her. You can't take him. God could not destroy Sodom until they got out. Your prayers is what builds a hedge around your lost children, your lost loved ones. God sent angels to pull them out of hell because of one man's prayer. Israel was at the Canaan border. They doubted God could bring them into the promised land.
So what do they do?
What we do best. Murmur and complain.
We can't have a revival. We don't have a church building. Boy, we just had a better sound system. Man, if we just had our own building, we'd have revival. No.
The Bible says that this is after they had 12 spies go in, 10 spies come back.
I don't like negative people. I'm sorry.
I went to work a few weeks ago, so I said, on a Monday morning, I come back from a Red Hot Revival service. I said, good morning, Mr. Moser. What's good about it? It's Monday. I said, I'll tell you what's good about it.
He said, what?
I said, it's Monday. I said, at Thursday morning at 2 a.m., these people are going to put a check in my account. I said, this is Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. I said, 3 more days, and they put money in my bank for being out here. That's what's good about Monday. I said, I got to let me know when I come back Monday, I got a job. So, you know, it just depends on how you look at it. When I start back over on Monday, that means that cat's going to pay me Thursday. I'm going to be able to buy groceries like I need it. But 12 spies go. 10 come back and say,
can't do it.
Can't have a revival in Durango. Can't have a move of God in Las Vegas. I told your pastor a few days ago, I called him, spoke to him, I said, God gave me a word. I told him, I said, how long has this church been here? How long has it been a church in Vegas? 34 years. You know what I told your pastor? He's talking about all the demons y'all fighting. I said, I'm going to tell you why you're fighting demons. Because you have a revival. I said, you're waking up devils that's been dead for 30 and 40 years. You're waking up demonic spirits that's been lying dormant. And you're praying and you're fasting. And the devil's mad. Why? Because you're getting people by the hand. And you're trying out of hell. You're getting people out of the street. And you're trying out of hell. It's not time for you to look back. There's nothing to go back to.
two spies say, you know what? We can do this. All I need is two folks to say we can take Las Vegas. We can take Durango. All you need is a couple of people that's just hard at it. The Bible says, verse 14, the congregation lifted up their voice and cried to the people.
What's our cry, baby?
Children of Israel murmured against Moses. Listen. And against Aaron, the whole congregation said to them, would to God that we had died in the land of Egypt.
You're going to get your wish, baby.
It's coming.
Hold on, one world, I go to church.
Man, I had a guy tell me one time. God, I mean, come to the altar one night. I was preaching revival, and he come down. He comes skidding down that altar. Crackhead, meth head. He said, man, I got to have the Holy Ghost. I said, I know you do. Prayed for him, God delivered him. I'm talking about this dude had no broke down truck, had barely had a job, suicidal in his thoughts. Come down, got the Holy Ghost. A few days later, got him a job. A couple months later, got him a nice truck. Working, doing good, wearing good clothes, eating good food. I went by to see him one day. He said, I could tell something was wrong with me. I said, man, what's wrong with you, buddy? How you doing?
I ain't doing good, man.
I said, what do you mean you ain't doing good? You don't realize what I gave up. I said, really? He said, you don't realize what I gave up to live for God. I said, let me get this right. You was walking when I found you because your truck was broke down. You barely had money to buy clothes. You were strung out on meth and strung out on crack. You were stealing everything you could get your hands on to buy the junk. And now look at you. You got a job. You got a church. You got clothes. And I said, what you going back to? What have you gave up? What have you let go of beside a life of sin and degradation? But I come to tell you tonight, when God drags you out of hell, don't look over your shoulder and say, I would to God I died there. I come to tell somebody, you need to get another hope on God and say, I'm going to live for you no matter what I go through, no matter what I face. So they murmured and complained.
Murmured and complained always.
Would God we die in Egypt? When God drags you out of hell, don't look back. And would God we die here in this wilderness? Guess what?
You're going to.
I don't know if I'm going to make it. I'm going to tell a story. Y'all taping this? I'll leave the name out to protect the innocent. Or the guilty, should I say. Years ago,
I know y'all think I'm shotgunning right now, but I'm telling you, God's on
to
something in this place.
My dad pastored a church in the Midwest. Had a lady in a church, and she had a bad, poor mouth. She walked in the office. She come up to the office door. Look. Now, my two brothers and I, we like pizza. And when we was all young boys at home, you know, 13, 14, 15, 16 years old, we go eat a pizza hut after church on Sunday night. That's our night. You don't mess with Sunday night. You don't mess with Friday night. That's our night. But this lady had problems. She come in church, doc. She knock on the door of my dad's office. Boy, Yates, I need to talk to you. And here we go. I was a young preacher. He said, son, go out there and start church. Well, I know I'm telling this for a reason. He said, go out to start church. If I'm not out there in time, just preach.
Okay.
Man, it's happened two or three times. I had to preach. Him and mom's in there counseling this lady. Same old story. I don't even want to live anymore. I just want to die. I don't feel like living. Ain't nothing going right for me. Poor old pitiful me. God done drug her out of hell. A typical backslide. Couple weeks later, I mean, this went on for about 5 months. Messed up her Sunday night pizza night, messed up her Friday night pizza night, because mom and dad's in there counseling. I'm not making light of counseling, folks.
So one particular night, I'm sitting in the office. My dad's in there schooling me on some things, talking to me, mentoring me, telling me some things that God had been showing him, what we're doing in the church. And somebody, and he said, oh, God. He said, I'm mad. That's all right, I'm doing. Yeah, no more pops. He's a big old dude, ain't he, brother? Big guy. I mean, big old hulk and a man. So he says, dude, he locked the door. I didn't talk about Yates. So I went out. He said, go get your mom. So I left the office door, stepped out, told mom to come here. So he goes in, they shut the door. And he told me, you know what to do. So the first song, I'm singing the first song, and I hear the door slam nearly off the hinges. Boom! I mean, it's so loud, it startled me. So down on both sides of that church was Sunday school rooms, and each Sunday school room had a door on each side. And he had to go all the way through those doors to come out the back of the church and sit on the back pew. She slammed every door down that little Sunday school area. And it was, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 6 doors. She slammed them. I'm talking about, I thought she snatched the handle off of them. Walked back, plopped down on the back pew. Mad. We didn't see her for a month. We didn't ask. All me and my two brothers knew we were going to eat pizza. She ain't missing our Pizza Hut date. So a few weeks go by, about a month or so. Here she come, big smile on her face. After church, it pops. So so-and-so's like, yeah, no. She called me that one because she come back. I told her, yeah. I said, well, what happened that night? He said, well, you know, she walks in, plops down on the couch. Your mom sits over and puts her arm on the shoulder. It's going to be all right. And he said, what's wrong? She said,
I just wish I could die.
And that big old 6-foot, 270-pound dude stood up over that desk and said, I wish to God you would die. I never had to look at your old sad face again. She slammed every door in the hall.
Can I tell you something? That was in 1985. I preached in that same church in 2010, and she's still there on the front row, raising her hands and worshiping God. She told my dad, she said, that's the best thing ever happened to me. She said, I needed somebody to tell me that. And you know what? God filled her son with the Holy Ghost, her husband with the Holy Ghost. I mean, you just got to get your mind made up to live for God. Murmuring and complaining and looking for a way out and find you a way in. That was free. That didn't cost you nothing. Let me show you something. Israel, they leave Egypt headed to the promised land. It's only 240 miles as a crow flies. It took them 40 years to get there. It was a 40-year death march. 40 years. They waited on everybody over 20 to die. Can you imagine? Oh, my God, Brother Walker. The last old coot that was living. Because the campfire stories that Joshua and Caleb could tell.
My God, have mercy.
We go all over as soon as the last murmuring, complaining, doubting old soul dies. I can see them going to Sister Complainer's door. You up?
Yeah, I'm up.
And then they go over here to Mr. Fault-Finding, blaming on everybody else's door.
You up?
You there?
Hey!
He ain't answering. Go get Joshua. And they go get Joshua by the hand. Say, come on, man. Mr. Doubt and Complainer over here. Knock on that door and see if he's in there. You ain't getting an answer either, are you? Go check him out. So Josh goes in. You can sit down. He goes in. He's dead.
All we waiting on is old Merman complaining. Sister Merman complaining. All we doing is, I'm telling y'all something. There is just a few demons that stand between you and your breakthrough. God have mercy. You got. I believe that when they knocked on Sister Merman's door and there was no answer, there was a shout that went through that camp. Today's our day. The last carcass has fallen. Today is the day that Joshua will lead us into the promised land. So I'm telling you tonight, when God drags you out of hell, don't you look back. Don't murmur, don't complain. Make up your mind that we're going forward. We're going to have revival. If we got to have church in a hay barn or a cow stall, we're going to have a move of God. God is calling this church to a revival to save the lost. He was mad at them because they forgot his miracles. God wants you to remember everything he's done for you. He's frustrated with them, with their desire to want to go back to bondage. Why do you want to go back to what you were? Don't even entertain the thought of it. I won my wife to God in 1986. I went to a little hamburger joint in Winsboro, Louisiana. If you ever go to Winsboro, Louisiana, go to Big John's. They got the best hamburger you'll ever put your mouth on. Man, I got a witness. I looked over there. She was waiting on me. And I was waiting on her. My Lord. She didn't have the Holy Ghost. But she still looked good. First time I laid eyes on her, my mom and I was in there eating. I told her, I said, Mom, that's going to be my wife right there. She said, go ask her out. I said, nope. She can't go to church for me. But I really didn't want Mom to know. I didn't want Mom to see me, you know, talking that game up there. You know what I'm saying? So I slid back in there a couple days later by myself. And ordered me a hamburger and a lollygag up there at the counter. And I talked to her. Invited her to a church skating party. She laughed at me. She thought, here I was. Listen, a smoking, drinking, partying, wild child, and this Pentecostal boy wants to invite me to go to a church skating party. Really? All night youth lock-in. But I will never forget. Oh, my God. She came to church on a Sunday morning. I was a Sunday school teacher and youth leader. 17-year-old kid. Man, it's all I could do, teach that Sunday school lesson, because she sure looked good sitting over there. So that night, she comes to church again. And my old man, Lord have mercy, dangled us over the pits of hell. He preached hell so hot, I went to the altar. I said, Pop, my God, Pops, you're going to run her off. Tears streaming down her face. All that Maybell, was it Maybelline, whatever makeup stuff is, all running down her face, all on her shirt, collar crying. And man, she, when that altar call comes, she goes to the altar. After church, we're on our way back to town, we're going to Big John. I'll never forget the words she spoke to me. She said, I don't know if you and I will ever make it. I don't know if I'll ever see you again. But what I felt in that church service tonight, I don't ever want to be away from that again in my life. Whatever God's got for me, I want it. It's been 32 years, and God drove her out of hell, and she ain't never looked back. I come to tell you, this is the greatest decision you will ever make in your life, is when you give yourself to God. He said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Truth changes you.
Just knowing the truth ain't good enough, but truth makes you free. When God brings salvation to you, and you're born again, you're made free. Stay free.
You know, a lot of people quote that scripture, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. That ain't what it says. Set means just open up the cage and let it go.
Made free is when you catch that little fox, or you catch that wolf pup, or you catch that little hog, and you domesticate them, and they become your friend. They don't try to kill you. They don't try to bite you. That's made free. When you get born again of the Holy Ghost, when you're born again of the Word of the Spirit, and you become a new creature, and the old man passes away, and all things become new, you're made free. You are not under the yoke of bondage. Paul said, "Son of the brethren, we are not the children of a bondwoman, but of the free." He said, "You're not bound anymore. You're not a child of bondage. You are a child of what God has given you, the freedom and the liberty of the Holy Ghost." Why would you want to turn in Galatians 4 now where it talks about going back to the weak and beggarly elements of this world? I don't know who I'm preaching to tonight, but I come to tell you, honey, when God gets you by the hand, don't linger around and decide, well, I think I'll wait around a little bit and look over my shoulder. I'm not looking over my shoulder, darling. I'm moving forward. Looking back will cause you to lose your place in the kingdom of God. That's scripture, Luke 9:62, when Jesus said, "No man, having put his hand in the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God."
That scripture bothered me. Because I know people had their hand in the plow and backslid. Come back, I don't know. I said, "God, what's that scripture mean?" When I looked up that word, fit,
it means well-placed, that is figuratively, appropriate, fit, mate.
God said, when you look back, you lose your place in line. You got to go back and get in line. You used to make me mad when I had to get out of line. I forget my wallet, I had to go out of line, go get back out of long line because I left my wallet in the truck. You lose your place.
So when you start looking over your shoulder,
everybody do this right here. Everybody reach out forward, straight forward. Look straight forward.
It's hard to look behind you when you're reaching at it. Brother, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do.
Forgetting.
He didn't say forget. He said forgetting. If you're going to live for God, you got to be in the forgetting mode all day, every day. Forgetting those things which are behind. Because if you look over your shoulder, you're going to turn to a pillar of salt. You're going to be of no value. You're not going to make any progress. Or you're going to be as a memorial for somebody to walk by and say, "That was a preacher."
Yeah, come on.
I know.
That's it. Come on.
Reach
forward.
Kind of hard to do, ain't it? You can't see what's behind you. So just keep reaching, darling.
Yeah.
Sis right there, piano player, come here. Come here. You. Yes, ma'am. Tonight, while you were playing the piano, God showed me, and this is what he said, hell has attacked you with everything it's got. And I saw it like all fours, hands and knees was on your chest. And just trying to hold you down. There's anointing. And hell hates anointing. In the name of Jesus, you're a child of God. You're a minister of music. You lead in music. You play in music. And I saw it.
It's like he was on his he had you by his shirt and his knees and your chest was holding. That's what I saw.
Not no more.
I release you. I bind every spirit of hell that's come against you, that's come against your family, that's come against your home, that's come against your marriage.
Oh!
Son of my devil, you spirit of hell, loose her right now. She is God's child. She is an order of the Holy Ghost. What hell and what hell is trying to wrestle from you is your anointing. And you have wrestled, you have fought, you have prayed, and you have struggled. And tonight it's over, sis. Hell can't touch you. In the name of Jesus, I bind every demonic spirit that's attacked her. You can't have her anointing. In the name of Jesus, somebody ought to get on their feet right now and give God some glory. He said, forgetting what's behind and reaching forward, you got to continue to reach forward. Don't look over your shoulder. Don't look behind you. Reach forward. When God drags you out. Healing is the word God spoke when I looked at you tonight. Healing. In the name of Jesus. You need healing in your body? Okay. So I didn't miss it, did I? You in pain right now? Okay. In the name of Jesus. Marobo Soto Galabahai. In the name of Jesus. Ha. Marushakatai. Marose. The way you're going to know that God's doing the work is just going to feel like fresh oil running from the top of your head down to the soles of your feet. When that happens, that's the sign. The Holy Ghost is in this room right now. You don't have to walk out of here without the Holy Ghost. Hey, did that fresh oil flow? Did that anointing flow? Did you feel that anointing? It's there in Jesus' name. I curse the condition and sickness in this body. Hey, I'm done preaching. The Holy Ghost is in here to move right now. My Lord, have mercy. If you're in this room and you want the Holy Ghost, you have it right now. Come on. My God, have mercy. Let's stand. Oh, hallelujah. Mare koyo roho roshata yala bandai. Hallelujah. Does anybody in this building want the Holy Ghost? If you want the Holy Ghost, I want you to just come up in front. Don't be afraid. Come on. The Holy Ghost is here. I'll come to you, don't matter to me. If you want the Holy Ghost, God will do it right now. Come on. God's got somebody by the hand right now trying to pull you out. Trying to drag you out. Sis, there's a new anointing going to settle on you. That weight that's been right here, you've been wrestling, it's gone. It lifted, did it not? Did it lift? Or I don't want to put words in your mouth. You want the Holy Ghost? Come on.
My God, have mercy.
In the name of Jesus Christ, God, fill this man with the baptism of the Holy Ghost right now. I release him. Begin to worship him right now. Yes! Yes! Turn it loose! Come on. Is following you to this house right here. You want the Holy Ghost? God's here tonight. You don't have to walk out of here without the Holy Ghost. Come on, brother, turn it loose right there. Turn it loose. Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost. That's it, brother. Worship it right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Can I pray for you? In the name of Jesus. God, right now, don't you touch this man's body. I want you to strengthen him, God. Fill him with your power right now. In the name of Jesus, I love you, God. Heal this man's body. Touch his mind, soul, and strength. Jesus! Echo Shadabanda!
Come on, the Holy Ghost is in this house. You, I bind every demon of hell that's tormented your mind, soul. I release you right now.
That's it.
The Holy Ghost is in this house. Hallelujah. How you feel, brother? Huh? Did you get the Holy Ghost?
I did. I think I did. The Holy Ghost is in here.
Hallelujah. Can I pray for you?
Come here.
The Holy Ghost was all over you during song service, wasn't it? Huh?
You want the Holy Ghost? You ready? Huh? You already have it?
Let him renew you right now in Jesus' name. Father, let the power of the Holy Ghost flow through this child right now. I want you to yield to the Holy Ghost. God has called you out. Let the Holy Ghost flow through you right now. In the name of Jesus, God, I give you everything in my life. In Jesus' name. Come on, the Lord's working in this house right now, right now, right now. The Holy Ghost is flowing right now. In Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus, let the Holy Ghost flow, man. In the name of Jesus Christ, that's it. Let the Holy Ghost flow. Let it flow in Jesus' name. Ramoros. There's somebody in this room right now God wants to heal. There's a healing. There's a healing in this room. Somebody in this room in pain? Step out. In Jesus' name. The pain's gone. Hallelujah. She said, I had a 9 when it come to pain on a scale from 1 to 10. pain's gone. Yeah, go ahead and give him glory right there. Go ahead and give him some praise.
Man. Lord,
in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. The presence of the Lord is in this house.
Sir, can I pray for you? In the name of Jesus, Lord, let the power of the Holy Ghost fall right now. God, you see the hunger in this man's heart. My God, I see you grabbing his family by the hand, dragging them out. Don't look back. Don't look back. In the name of Jesus, I release you the power and authority of the Holy Ghost right now. Let it flow through you, sir. In the name of Jesus. That's it. Come on. Come on, turn that tongue. That's it. Yes. My God. Let go. Don't go by. Come on. God's giving you direction right now. You say, God, I need direction. The direction is toward God, away from the world. My God, make all my sin out of us. In the name of
Jesus. Hallelujah. What's your name, brother? Jared? The hand of God is on your life. If you will submit to his will and his purpose, he is going to use you for his kingdom to destroy Satan's kingdom. Look, there's a hunger right here in that heart. I'm going to go this far. There's a call of God on your life. And you got to yield to it. And God is calling you to step up. And tonight is your night. I'm not looking back. Is this your wife? May I pray for both of you? You mind if I pray for you?
Let the Holy Ghost flow through right now. In the name of Jesus. God, touch this family. In the name of Jesus Christ. Come on, let the Holy Ghost flow through right now. It's all right. In the name of Jesus. God, I'm asking you right now to touch this lady. God, touch her mind, body, and soul. Deliver her, God, of any sickness. God, any disorder that she's battling right now, heal her right now. In Jesus' name.
Jared, there's some things that God wants to heal in his marriage, to touch and strengthen. God's hands on your life. Walk with him. As he got Abraham, as Lot, he got him by a hand and said, don't linger. I'm going to lead you out of destruction. If you will follow the Holy Ghost, he would lead you out of destruction. In Jesus' name. It's up to you, sir. She's going to follow. In Jesus' name. God bless you. Hallelujah. God's going to give you tunnel vision. You're going to focus. And you're going to be able to see where God wants you to go. And he's going to order your steps. If you'll follow him, he will order his steps with his word. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. And in all thy ways acknowledge him. All of your ways, not some of them, all of them. And he will give you the desire of your heart. God bless you. In Jesus' name. Come on, church. Somebody's being born again right here. Come on. That's it. Come on.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
When you begin to speak that language, let it go. In the name of Jesus. Come on, I want you to turn it loose. Don't worry about what it sounds like. In the name of Jesus. Loose it in Jesus' name. Yeah, come on, Gianna, come on. Come on, it's all over you. Turn it loose. Come on, somebody's getting the Holy Ghost right here, right now. My God, have mercy. How you feel? Can I tell you something? Let me tell y'all something right now. Do you know what the sign of the Holy Ghost is? It ain't cutting cartwheels. It ain't kicking chairs over. It ain't crying. It ain't shouting. It's talking in tongues. Well, I didn't feel a bolt of lightning striking it. There's some people get the Holy Ghost and tear the whole place up. But the sign of the Holy Ghost is speaking in tongues. It didn't say you had to speak in tongues 30 minutes. 5 words, 1,000 words, they begin to speak with tongues as the Spirit give utterance. Come on, clap your hands and worship Him right now. Hallelujah. I know I'm standing between y'all and something to eat. I want to tell you something, sir. This your wife? Hand of God's on y'all's life. Take her by the hand. You know what the devil really liked to do? Boy, isn't this a beautiful couple? Man, they dress nice. Got their hair combed nice and pretty. And you know what the devil wants to do? Let me get in between here. Huh? You know why? Because he knows. He knows what's right here and right there. He knows what you want to do for God. And he said, if I can stop him, I'm going to stop him. If I can crush him, I'm going to crush him. If I can destroy her, I'm going to destroy her. God. Hallelujah. Sis, you are the greatest asset to him or his greatest detriment. Decide what you want to do. I mean, He can't go nowhere without you in ministry. God has put you together for a purpose. Do it.
Do it, sir. Do it.
You can't go nowhere without her. Do you know what I saw when I laid hands on you two guys? Bible studies. Souls. That's what I saw. That's what I saw. You speak Spanish? Fluent? Okay. God's got a ministry for you. Can you read Spanish? You teach a Spanish Bible study? Okay. Souls. You speak Spanish? She can teach you. You speak enough, you got her.
My God, no robo hosa rabande.
In Jesus' name, in the name of Jesus, Carlos. The presence of the Lord is in this house. When God drags you out of hell, don't look back. In building a church, God needs people to build a church. He needs ministry to build a church, workers to build a church, soul winners to build a church. Everybody's a soul winner. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Why don't we lift our hands and worship Him right now in this place? When Jacob went to Bethel, he came back through with his wives and children. He lost Rebecca's nurse, and they buried her under an oak. They buried her at Bethel. There's things that when you build an altar, you have to let go of. You have to bury. When you build an altar, there's things you have to bury. My God, have mercy. There's things in this building tonight that God is saying you got to let it go. And you got to bury it. Get rid of it. There's a deep move of the Holy Ghost in this place. Anybody been touched tonight? Anybody been healed, delivered? Hallelujah. My Lord and my God. One more time, let's worship Him. Let the robo hosso torrebana. Catorrebenei la robo hosso torrebenai. My God, I praise you, Jesus. I see God getting people by the hand tonight and dragging them out of hell. Don't look over your shoulder. Move forward. Let the power of the Holy Ghost lead you and guide you. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Ha 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 ha.
Hallelujah. God's hands on your life. Many will look at you and call you blessed. Many. You will be looked up to, reverenced as the mother of this church, even at a young age. The hand of God. Who would have thought a little girl from North Louisiana? God's going to use you in a mighty way. Because of your sacrifice, no complaining, murmuring. He said, my hands on you. My blessings are on you. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. There's no telling what God will do in this place Sunday. There ain't no telling. He's moved miraculously in this house tonight. God's a good God. There are some things that God just healed in you right now. Let them stay healed. Don't uncover them. Let them go. Okay? Hallelujah.
Well, we all lift our hands right now. Let's just begin to thank the Lord. Come on, He's done great things among us tonight. Somebody let a heartfelt praise come from the depths of your soul right now. Let heaven hear your gratefulness right now. Come on. We thank you, Jesus. All eternity will tell the deliverance, the victory, the power. All the doors that will open tonight in this place. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Now could we just give the Lord a good hand clap of praise? He is worthy. He is worthy. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Brother Yates, for obeying the Holy Ghost. Amen. It has been a wonderful night. We're going to pray now for our food. Then we're going to dismiss you to the fellowship hall. Let's go to the Lord in prayer for our food. Jesus, thank you again for this wonderful night. Thank you for walking among us.